to say, man. Tone of the clothing, you looking like a real sucker in them comments, my nigga. Yeah, homie, you a $1 million nigga, homie. You looking like a real sucker in them comments, my nigga. Now, you bragging about you didn't pay. Yeah, you right, homie. I didn't charge you nothing, nigga. I kept it 100 with you, nigga. But say, nigga, how you gonna say you fuck with me and don't know nothing about me, but you bringing me around your son, your girl. You brought me all up in your house. You taking me out to eat. Nah, nigga, you rolled my dick now. You paid. Nah, you paid now, nigga. Don't act like you didn't pay. Nah, you pay, nigga. You dick rolled like a motherfucker, nigga. You ought to be pregnant the way you rolled my dick. Yeah, nigga, and I bless your game, cause nigga, your views don't do like with Charleston White, so don't get too cocky, millionaire, nigga. Them big old slow punches you throwing, nigga, you ain't no killer, nigga. Ain't nothing about you, no killer, nigga. Nigga, them slow ass punches you throwing, nigga, I know some niggas will make your knees buckle and make you poop and shit after you poop, nigga. I know some niggas will beat your body up, nigga, big old slow ass nigga. Now you cut it out, Tony the Closer. Nah, nigga, you ain't no gorilla. You a orangutan. You ain't no motherfucking silverback, nigga. You all in the motherfucking comment section talking, nigga. You ain't no motherfucking silverback Tony the Closer. You a motherfucking orangutan, big slow punch throwing motherfucker. You don't even know how to put your hips into that shit, nigga. You shoulder throwing ass, nigga. I know a nigga dip right up under that and stay in your chest. Nigga, your chin ain't been tested, nigga. You better pipe down, big fella. No, you better pipe down, big fella. Yeah, big old soft ass teddy bear, nigga. No, you better quit barking like, nigga, you a straight up mog, my nigga. And you a big scary nigga. Nigga, stop talking like you what that is, nigga. You a big old millionaire, a woman beater, nigga. Shut up, nigga. Fuck wrong with you, nigga. Scary ass nigga. Nigga, fuck you, nigga. You brought me around your kids and your woman, homie. So don't get on here talking and faking and shaking, nigga. You brought me into your home, nigga. So stop faking and shaking with that. I hate you, and you an industry nigga. You your mother, nigga. You a nigga, please, nigga. You niggas ain't nothing like me, nigga. You now you on here insulting people because them niggas handling you. Nigga, you wrong. How is it you gonna bring a nigga around your woman, your two boys, your family, your relatives, introduce me to everybody, take me around, fly down and come see me, nigga? You flew to Dallas to come see me, nigga. And then you asked for me to put you with other people to do interviews and things. Come on, homie, now don't act like you wasn't trying to fuck with me. See, you a fuck boy ass nigga, homie. All you industry niggas, homie, you niggas don't know no loyalty, nigga. And you ain't stomped down and 10 toes down on nothing, Mark. Nah, nigga, when the bitch said to you, nigga, and like I told you on the phone, nigga, when the bitch said to me, nah, nigga, you said, well, he say, nah, homie, you threw me for a loop with that one. So, nigga, so if you ain't went and looked at me and me and you done chopped game, nigga, you done had your sons around me sitting at my feet listening to me. You got your cousin around you, nigga, praising me and worshiping me. Nigga, I took you to the academics video, all that, nigga. So you got all these people in your immediate family listening to me and you saying you don't know what I do. You a straight up hoe ass nigga. Nah, you a straight up hoe ass nigga, my nigga. And you in the bitch fire, sucker. What he say? So the bitch hadn't done no research and you hadn't done no research. Nigga, you been running behind me, kissing my ass, sucking my dick, nigga, and massaging the heel of my toe, nigga. Fuck you talking about you. You don't, nigga, you know something about me. What made you jump on my lap then? What made you bring me a gun, nigga? We can talk about it. What made you bring me the gun, nigga, in Miami? If you hadn't saw, what had you been listening to that made you bring your girl and your sons when you brought me that gun in Miami for Soulja Boy? Huh? Tony the Closer. What did you know about me? So you mean to tell me a nigga you don't know, you go meet him with your woman and your children and bring this nigga a gun so he can hold a gun? Come on, nigga. And you don't know nothing about me? And you done that? Oh, nigga. Between your sons and your cousin around you, nigga, I thought y'all knew everything about me the way y'all talked and praised me. So you now you get in front of this bitch You really scared of the bitch. I saw how you bowed and buckled to the bitch, nigga. Oh, you be, I don't want, boy, if you get, I saw how you bowed and buckled to the bitch. And then, nigga, I peep your play, how you really try to out Charleston, you crazy. Nah, nigga, you don't do what I do, nigga. You another nigga talking on the internet, nigga. You another nigga talking on the internet, Tony boy. Tony boy, you another nigga talking on the internet, nigga. Let me show you the difference between me and y'all niggas. Now listen up real good, Tony boy. You hear me? Listen real good here, boy. You in the bitch. Yeah, nah, man, I'm sitting back thinking, nah, man, that nigga really trying to play on me. This nigga begged me, man, when can you come to Miami? This nigga always begging me, man, when you come to Miami? Man, we need to do something together. This nigga begging me for a partnership. This nigga begging me for a partnership. Come on, homie, don't do me like that, my nigga. And I kept it 100 with you. I never charged you for an interview, my nigga. Kept it 100 with you. On a simple fact, you brought me a gun, nigga. I kept it player with you. Not that I owed you nothing, nigga, but I see a simple fact, nigga came and while I was in distress, I didn't need the gun. Cause them Haitian niggas came too, nigga. I didn't need the gun. You voluntarily brought the gun without even talking to me, nigga. You wanted to jump in my lap so goddamn bad. Nigga, I kept it 100 with you, my nigga. So let me show you what you niggas don't do, my nigga. This is heartbreaking. Nigga, I knew you. I knew you was a sidewinder kind of nigga. And mama say you don't never be mad at a motherfucker for who they are. Mama say you don't never be mad at a motherfucker for who they are and the type of person that they are. You don't be mad at them people for that. You deal with them accordingly. Now you done expose yourself, nigga. I ain't mad at who you are. You done expose yourself, nigga. I'm dealing with you accordingly, nigga. Nah, you steady talking to me, man. I fuck with you. You my nigga. I fuck with you, dawg. You call me every other day. I'm just checking on you. You acting like we brothers. That's how you playing on me, my nigga. You acting like me and you brothers. You acting like we friends. So I'm thinking you my partner. So I'm treating you like I would treat a friend, my nigga. Keeping it 100 with you all the way around. My nigga in town, say, homie, we go get some interviews. I'm gonna get you. Nah, I'm really throwing you alley hoops, my nigga. But I see you really playing on me. That's how you talking in this comment section. Like you been playing on me. I let everybody know, homie, you go fuck me before I fuck you. I tell everybody when we meet, nigga, you'll fuck me before I fuck you. And here go another example of a nigga playing on me before I play it on him. Now I'm gonna let you play on me before I play on you, my nigga. See, cause I know how to roll off that shit, nigga. Yeah, I know how to build off a nigga playing on me. Yeah. I let a nigga play on me so he can show me who he is. Yeah, I play possum. Yeah, I play possum like a motherfucker. Yeah, I let the nigga think he playing on me. So I'm reading your comments, homie. First, I wouldn't even go speak on none of this shit, my nigga. I'm like, okay, the nigga exposed himself. It is what it is. What's under? So I see y'all in the comments section, nigga. You going back and forth with people you don't even know, nigga. You writing paragraph. You invite niggas to fight. You done got tough in it. I said, nah, man, this nigga really exposing himself as a mog. As a straight up sucker. Nah, this nigga looking like a lame in that comment section. And nigga, after I read one too many comments that you had responded to, I said, oh, this $1 million nigga in his feelings. This nigga done put his shirt on, he done put this skirt on and raised his motherfucking skirt on. Boy, he letting his comments expose his clitoris. Oh, this nigga done expose his clitoris, y'all. This nigga got a Rolls Royce truck, homie. This nigga stand up in a high rise so motherfucking high in Miami. This nigga arguing with people online, my nigga, in the comment section. Oh, this nigga really a mog, man. Let me pull back from this sucker all the way. Nah, he done exposed himself. Don't be mad at him for exposing himself. But man, get away from that sucker. Cause well, we know to stay sucker free. Nah, that nigga real life sucker, man. And you don't be mad at a sucker for being a sucker. You just don't suck on the sucker. You get away from the sucker, man. Yeah, that's how that go. So now I see what you is, nigga, because you done been exposed and identified for who you are. You ain't my kind, nigga. I swear for God, you ain't my kind. My kind wouldn't dial. Let no bitch get, not no funky bitch like that, but you scared of the bitch, nigga. Yeah. But the niggas like you that beat up the bitches. Yeah. You nigga beat up the bitches. I ain't got no history of beating up the bitch. I beat up the pussy. And every now and then slip a finger in the asshole. But that's about the most I'm gonna do. Yeah, no. That nigga done made me mad, the motherfucker. He all in the comment section. He broke. Man, come on, homie. That's just like the bitch. The bitch go holler, you got the little dick, you got AIDS, you gay or you broke. That's the bitch response, nigga. Yeah, that's the bitch response, nigga. Nigga, I'm, yeah, that's the bitch response. Hold on, I got something for you niggas. I'm finna put you niggas ass in class. That's what I'm finna do. Yeah, I'm finna put you niggas ass in class. That's what I'm finna do.
Yeah, bitch ass nigga. Yeah, nigga, nah, man, I'm sitting, nigga, I wasn't tripping at first. I just so happened to be looking through the comment section. I said, oh, man, this nigga in here talking like he been playing on me. Yeah, he talking to me like we Starsky and Hutch kind of friends. Yeah, I'm thinking we Starsky and Hutch. I'm keeping this nigga done brought. Nah, man, I'm thinking we Starsky and Hutch. This nigga playing on me. Like I'm Screech. Yeah, he trying to treat me like I'm Screech. Off Saved by the Bell, and he's that. Don't nobody want to hear Tony the Closer talk about a motherfucking thing. He dull. He dull. I'm thinking, this nigga trying to handle me like I'm Screech. And I'm thinking, this is some Starsky and Hutch kind of shit. See, that's what happens. You think you can make, these industry niggas is not to be making friends with. Man, you do business, man. I'm glad my man, Yeah, man, I be trying to keep it 100 with these niggas. Hold on. Cut this shit out.
Hey, I plead a legal cost in Texas Western University. We were doing a presentation on human trafficking. And people came in and had a chance to meet one another. And when I listened to his story, I'm very much inspired. And it left an indelible mark on me, what he had to say. So, from time to time, I asked Charleston to come here as a guest speaker, especially with my introduction to law enforcement classes. And he comes and he shares his story and his knowledge and his wisdom with you all. So, I've asked him to come today. Agrees to come, he's here. So I'm going to bring you up, Charleston, and I will allow you to tell the class a little bit about yourself and your story.
Yeah,
this is Charleston.
I still call him Agent Owen, because I know him when he was with the department, and he spontaneously wanted me to come back and repeat this supposedly exceptional presentation that I did at the last class, so I don't know if I can repeat it, but I tend to do a lot of public speaking. I travel around the country. I spoke at University of Arkansas, Prairie View A&M, different colleges, John Jay College in New York.
Really? That's beautiful.
I've gone to Washington, D.C. Several years and worked with probably at least different 50 different U.S. congressional members on different juvenile laws in the country. One in particular, we got juvenile life without parole abolished in this country up until 2 years ago. The United States of America and Sudan was two of the only countries on planet Earth that will take a 12-year-old and sentence them to life without parole with no possibility of ever getting out. So basically, that's a death sentence, right? When you think about America is one of the most free nations, supposed to be free nations, but we incarcerate more people than anyone on the planet, particularly our children. When all of the data, all of the research, all of the medical science says that the human brain does not develop to or at around age 25. And that's just typical, normal, right? But if you factor in trauma, child abuse, mental health, substance abuse, if you factor in all that, then that human brain may not develop to 35, 40, And so then you start getting rappers like Jay-Z saying 40 is the new 30. Well, you know, that's an undeveloped brain, or slow brain progress. So with that being said, my message, before I tell you about who and what I am and how I ended up here today, my message is no child is born bad. With all of that research and that data, based on my life experiences, based on my childhood friends, based on family, I've discovered that no child is born bad. Our psychologists and our sociologists say that environments play a part. And so I teach that children mimic what they see, repeat what they hear. At least I did. So I was born to a teenage mother. Mother had my brother at 15, had me at 17. Dad was in the Navy, don't know much about him. Probably can count on two hands how many times I've seen him in my lifetime. Grew up in traditional single parent home. Just mom now. Never been spanked by a man, never been disciplined by a man, never had a man put his arms around me, say, I love you, I'm proud of you. None of that. All I ever seen was mother. Mom landed a job at General Motors in the early 80s. So our life kind of went from rags to riches overnight, seemed like. So we left the projects, moved up out of Stop 6 Fort Worth by the time I was in the third grade. Early 80s, it was unheard of for a kid to have his own phone line in a room in the early 80s. But I had my own phone line in the early 80s. We, you know, we walked on marble floors, our bathtub was trimmed in gold. Mom provided a very, very financially stable, good home life for us. But she worked all the time, right? So when I was getting out of school, my mother was going to work. So it was basically, hey, mom, how you doing? Hey, I got dinner on the stove. Y'all leave your homework out. I'm going to call at such and such time. I'll see y'all when I get out. And don't y'all do this, this, and that. So basically, my brother and I, we grew up with no parental supervision. Man, we from probably from the time I was in the third grade up until I was 13, 14 years old, man. I was free to do whatever I wanted to do after school. My mama had to work. I ain't had no grandmother who my mom could call and say, hey, y'all come check on the kids. My mom didn't have no sisters, no brother. She didn't have the support. And back in the 80s, or early 80s, mid 80s, single motherhood was a stigma. It was like a curse. So single mothers didn't get a lot of support. There was no such thing as support for single mothers in the 80s. So a single mother had to do whatever she had to do with and for her children. And so basically for my mother, and I remember reminding her of this as I got grown, Mom, you didn't raise us. We just happened to grow up. Most of our life, you had to work. You had to. You couldn't stay home and teach us. We didn't sit around the table and eat. So you just made sure that the environment that we grew up in was a good environment. We wasn't at no one's house being abused, right? So my mom had an older brother, which was my uncle Wayne. Only male exposure that I probably remember having, other than a few other uncles, but just a major impact influence was my Uncle Wayne, and he was a pimp. So he's my own big brother, right? So you know how it is, mostly in a black family, the drug dealing uncle or the uncle with the money, the family treats him a little different. And so growing up as children, you notice how your family treats certain people. And so, you know, me growing up in my young and impressionable mind, I saw how Uncle Wayne was treated different. I got to see Uncle Wayne walk in with bags of money. Uncle Wayne wore a suit and jumped out of a Rolls Royce, and he had some beautiful women who were prostitutes, but we thought they was our aunts. That's how it was sold to us and told to us. That shit ain't such and such. That shit ain't such and such. So we don't know who she really is. And so most of my life, I hung with Uncle Wayne. I was his favorite nephew. My name is Charleston, but everybody called me Blue. We were just talking about that. It was a movie that came out in 77, 76, 77, 78. Well, I was born in 77. And this movie was called Come Back Charleston Blue. My dad's name is Charles. My mama's name is Charleston. Well, when they bring me home from the hospital, and my pimp uncle heard my name is Charleston, he liked this pimp movie called Charleston Blue. And so that's where I get my nickname from. And it stuck with me till this day. To this day, people still call me Blue. I got old elder aunties. When we go to a family reunion, they go get excited. Hey, there go that Charleston Blue. So, not knowing the influence that labels have. You know, y'all are going into law enforcement, right? Labels have a big influence. And labeling played a big part in my character, in the type of roles that I played throughout life. So let me get to the point. I'm just kind of taking you on through. My uncle, very abusive to women. I can remember waking up at times in the middle of the night. He whooping along. I got to get up and go to school the next morning. I can remember riding with him. He's going through the avenues and streets, stopping him, you know, on the streets, as we call it, checking money, picking up money from him. Maybe chastising them, cussing them out. And I rode in the car with them, kind of like as a family. McDonald's, getting a Happy Meal. He was my hero. Remember, never been spanked by a man, never been disciplined by a man, never had any affection by a man. That was the closest thing that I ever got to having a man in my life, other than my brother. My brother grew up very angry. From the simple fact of not having a dad. My mother was very loving, nurturing, very caring. But my brother was very angry from the simple fact of not having a dad. I never heard my mama say anything bad about my father. Don't know if he was, what kind of man he was. I never seen a man come out my mother's bedroom, but she had boyfriends. So whatever they did, them juggles was gone before we got up and woke up in the morning.
That's right.
So she tried to do what a good mother would do, right? Instill good morals, instill good values into her kids. But without that father piece in a boy's life, in typical African-American males, you have no identity. So when I leave off my mother's porch, I don't have no man to identify with. So when I'm playing with other little boys, I don't have no man to identify with other than Uncle Wayne, other than what I saw Mama do. So if I didn't have Uncle Wayne, then I would mimic my mother. And I was talking about a kid the other day in the other class. He used to sit down and pee. And we was 9, 10 years old. And we caught him sitting down peeing one time outside. And from that point on, he was bullied. He was picked on, but he had been growing up watching his mom sit down and pee. He ain't never seen a man stand up and pee. It's kind of like a kid, if you put him around wolves, he'll think he's a wolf if you grew up with him. Children mimic what they see and repeat what they hear. So a lot of little boys grow up in households and they ain't got no man. They got no man to mimic an image. So what happened, you become a kid like me, right? Uncle Wayne come and go. Uncle Wayne come and go. So in the process of him coming and going, I got my brother who's angry. He's going to TYC. He's in and out of trouble with the juvenile facilities, adolescent homes. I got my Uncle Joe. He got a bunch of guns laying around his house over there with my Aunt Nate. He's an abusive father. He's a womanizer. I got my granddad. He's a womanizer. And all these men done been in prison. Almost every man in my family done been in prison with a felony conviction. So in the process, I'm seeing these men within my family. So then when I step out in my community and I start paying attention to the other men out in the community, I start noticing the guys who came home from prison. When the guys came home from prison, they were celebrated. They had the biggest block parties that you could ever see in my community. And then I noticed when the kids graduated from high school, the third parties was nothing like the guys when you came home from prison party. These parties are boring. Man, this is the party I want. I don't want that high school party. I want that prison party. So you start seeing those things coming up, right? So then when you put on your headphones, it's 1988, 89, you put on your headphones, you start listening to gangster rap. Then here comes N.W.A. Here come Eazy-E, here come the Ghetto Boys. So then you get this new culture, right? You get this new culture that begins to propagate what you see in your family. It begins to solidify what you see in your community. So in your young and impressionable mind, you're exposed to things that you shouldn't be exposed to. So there's a guy by the name of Confucius that says, Confucius said, he who controls images controls minds. Why do you think they spend millions and tens of millions of dollars on commercial? Why do you think commercial and marketing is so powerful? He who controls images controls minds. And so you have a male image, a positive male image, a father figure image that's been removed, not just out of my home, but millions of homes in the black community, in the black village. Then all of a sudden, these images are replaced with gangster rap. Remember before the year, we had MC Hammer. We had Kid and Play, remember? Before then, we had dancing music. Then all of a sudden, these images come through. So I'm listening to the lyrics, and the lyrics is propagating and solidifying and glorifying. And mom's too tired to say, hey boy, let me listen to what you're listening to. All he heard was, turn that mess down. Turn it off. Hey, I don't want to, man, what was that? Cut that crap off. No one took the time to really listen what we was listening to. And so, when I take off my headphone, cut on television, here come the videos. The television propagated and solidified what I saw. So when I went to school, I became those images. I became those images. Eazy-E, N.W.A., man, they talked about everything. And we acted out some of those lyrics. We began to base our behaviors, our lives off those songs, those movies, and those videos. And we began to act them out. And by this time, I'm a kid who didn't have a father. I lost my eye playing with a homemade slingshot when I was like 7 or 8 years old. So I had an insecurity about losing my eye. So I had to develop. So I thought no one would pick on me. I developed a little man syndrome complex. You ask me about my eye, I'm punching you in your eye. So you know not to ask me because I punched him. Don't even ask me about it because that was something I didn't want to talk about. And then I was hurt because I felt rejected. I felt abandoned. I felt unloved. I felt unwanted. Because my old man ain't around. We live in the same city. And I can't see him. I don't get to see him. So I resented male authority figure. You could be my coach. You could be my English teacher. I hated any man telling me what to do. And you might genuinely like me. And you might genuinely care about me. But you can't come home with me. So get out of my face. I want you to come home and give me this discipline. So get out of my face if you can't come home with me. And so, I wasn't used to no man telling me what to do. I resented it. But a woman could say, hey, boy, pull them pants up. Yes, ma'am. Because I was used to my mother getting on to me. And it was easy for me to accept discipline and correction coming from a woman than it is from a man. So, after so long, mama, where my daddy at? Mama, can we go see my daddy? After so long, that hurt and that rejection, if it's not processed, Mom don't know what to say, and she ain't got the time, but she tired. She's frustrated. So I ain't got nobody to talk to about what I feel on the inside, right? So as a kid, you internalize everything, and you begin to blame yourself. And you need an outlet. You need an outlet. I didn't play sports. My mama had to go to work. We had nobody take us to football practice. So I needed an outlet. So my hurt and my pain evolved as it typically do. It turns into anger. At times it develops into hate. So what you see with my people in my community, you see a lot of hurt. Black men and black boys walking around that y'all went to school with, and you just say, man, he always act like he tough. Then he act like he can beat up everybody. He hurt. All the tough black guys with the big mean faces is walking around like they can beat up everybody they hurt. And that's an act that they gotta put on to disguise the hurt and the pain and the rejection. All that comes from not having a dad. And so, by the time I was 14, I had been arrested for shooting at people, breaking into houses, stealing cars, aggravated assault with an injury, beating up a girl at school, spitting her ear open. I had a very violent, lengthy juvenile arrest record. And a lot of my violence wasn't because I was violent. I was acting out of hurt as a kid with an undeveloped brain. It's just like, I like to give this example, right? Michael Vick took a whole bunch of dogs and taught them how to fight, kill one another. They fought to the death, right? They bred dogs to make them kill and fight one another. So when they went in and they rescued those dogs, they didn't lock those dogs up. They didn't put all them dogs to death. What they did, they gathered up all them dogs and put them in an environment where it was love. They nurtured them, and they loved and they nurtured those dogs back to their natural state, right? And they started having them adopted out. Well, we should take the same process to most children, because most children, where I come from, man, I didn't know pimping was wrong. I saw Uncle Wayne do it. And he said, when I was a kid, that, man, you ain't got no business messing with a woman if you ain't got nothing for her to do. And that stuck with me. When you get mad at a woman, you don't just holler at her and say, baby, you call her the B word. We was taught that. I know some dudes was taught to sell dope, man. They dad done it. And as they grew up, their dad taught them how to do it. And they taught their friends how to do it. And their mom them is in agreement with it. And their grandmothers is in agreement with it. And their aunts is in agreement with it. And their neighbors is in agreement with it. And these aren't bad people. Because if they wasn't selling dope, they'll be robbing. Or they'll be stealing. Or they'll be breaking in somebody's house. Or holding up a store. And so the dudes who sell dope say, nah, man, don't y'all do this, just come do this. Some people are taught that. Indirectly, we're told that men don't work. They say black men are lazy. Well, man, I ain't lazy. I just didn't know men work. As crazy as that sound, and as ironic as that sound, I ain't never seen a man get up and go to work. So how am I supposed to know? I ain't never seen no man get up and go to work. I thought women worked and men played in the streets. Did nobody tell me otherwise? When my uncles went to prison, man, did nobody come back and tell me nothing bad about prison? They glorified it. Made it sound bravado. They reinforced the thought that in order to be a man, you got to go to prison. I grew up wanting to go to prison. As crazy as that sounds, but I wanted to be a man. Every boy wanted to be a man. And where I'm from, in order to be a man, you got to go to prison. You got to shoot people. Where I'm from, those are the strong men. Not, I ain't seen nobody getting up going to work that was strong in my world. Just the strong women. And so, I grew up in a time, before I caught that murder, we had Ann Richards, Mark White. I was talking about Mark White, who was the governor before Ann Richards. I was talking about him earlier, that's why his name slipped out. But Ann Richards was our governor. And so, prior to catching the murder case, I had a very lengthy, violent juvenile arrest record. And this was in a short span of time. Beginning late 1990 to mid 1991, or late 1991, and it was small things gradually working up to big violent things: stealing cars, shooting at people, being accused of shooting at people. So it gradually worked its way up. So it was a process, and because I come from a good home. When I went to court and my mother showed up in the courtroom or the police station, they look at my mother and tell, this kid comes from a good home. My mannerisms. I was very charming and charismatic as a kid. I knew how to get in front of the judge and say, yes, sir, and no, ma'am, compared to my friends when they wouldn't talk that, right? So when they got in front of the judge, they yell, no, man, you know, so they didn't know how to clean up. And maybe they mother wasn't as well dressed, as articulate as my mother. Their mama probably came to court with rollers in her head and in her robe, and so he didn't get treated like I got treated, right? I was able to pick up on those type of things as a kid. And it was the same thing when you just come from a good home, so I knew to play the role. I was just with the wrong people at the wrong time. But I was the leader of the pack. Because I was smaller, I got a little favor. Big old black dude like him go to court, he'll get more time than me. He's darker, he's bigger. All that plays a part in the mind of a judge, a juror, a probate. All that plays a part. They don't teach that, but all that plays a part. How big and black. They think, if I saw him on a dark street, that juror would think, oh no, compared to a little old bitty guy like me. September 18, 1991. Me and three friends decided to skip school. I ran away from home. I was tired of my good life. I was tired of sleeping in my big old nice bed with an icebox full of food. And I wanted to live like the ghetto children. I was tired of walking on the marble floors, this big old beautiful brick home with the basketball goal. I was tired of all of my name brand clothes, my jabos and my polka dot shirts, the Kwame. And I was tired of all that good living, and I wanted to live like the ghetto children. I wanted to be able to not have no parental supervision. I was tired of my mother saying, I need to talk to their mama if you're going to spend a night over their house, what time you leaving. I wanted to live like the ghetto children. And my mother fought hard to make it out of that. And I fought hard to go back to it, driving my mama crazy, both my brother and I. Because in my culture, the ghetto, the gutter, the slums, if you want to be important, if you don't come from that, or if you're not a part of that, then you're not accepted and embraced as being authentic and bravado in the black community. A kid who didn't come from the projects, if he come down to his cousin's house, he got a fight. They gonna pick on him. Man, you ain't come from the hoods. You ain't real. I got it out the mud. You ain't get it out the mud. Your mom. So I wanted to go back to that. We made it out of that, and I wanted to go back. So that was the struggle between my mother and her children. She moved so far away from that, and we were trying to bring that to the place she was taking us to. That's how the name Arlington got Agtown. All these middle-class black people and middle-class people came to Arlington trying to get their kids away from that. They brought the ghetto with them. That's how Arlington got the name Agtown. So we decided to skip school one day. I done run away from home, and we've been having sex with teenage girls all night like we grown. We've been tricking with the dope fiends. If y'all don't know what that means, having sex with the grown women for crack. During 1991, you had crack addicts who looked like video models. Crack was new, right? It hadn't done its damage. We was able to sleep with our homeboys' mamas. We was able to sleep with our homeboys' grandmamas. So that's where you see the respect factor in our community is gone. Y'all forgot about the crack babies, right? They had to grow up. A lot of the problems you see in my community, crack babies are now adults and they have had children. And they suffer from a dual diagnosis, substance abuse and mental health abuse that hadn't been diagnosed. So we skip school. We go to the Farm 303 Mall. The plan was, we just go run in the Foot Locker, run out with the athletic jackets and go on about our business. But prior to that, we stopped by my girlfriend's house and broke into it. Her daddy was a Dallas police officer. We stole his gun, a bulletproof vest, they Nintendo, they Sega, they VCR, and ate a little bit of food out the icebox and went and sold that stuff. And we went on a crime spree as children. Just out committing crime, man, skipping school. And so we went to Farm 303 Mall, went in, ran out with the jackets. In the process, the little white Foot Locker dude looked like he was fresh out of high school, out of college, decided he wanted to chase us. When we get to the parking lot, it's another white dude in the parking lot working on his car. He had just got married 3 days prior, and he decided that he's going to die a hero today. He decided that he's going to die a hero. He had just got married. He should have been minding his business, man, letting him the little black boy, but he decided, I'm going to step in and try to stop them from getting away with them jackets. And in the process, he lost his life in broad daylight. All over some jackets. Man just got married. I remember reading in the newspaper when he took his wife out to eat. He had already went early that day and had a wedding ring placed inside a strawberry and put on top of a cake so when she bite the strawberry, she bite into the ring. That's how he proposed to her. I was real intrigued about reading about them and learning about them once I got grown because I never got a chance to read all the newspaper articles. Very, very high profile crime. Front page paper on every news station, talk TV, talk shows, all of that. I fell in the generation. That day I became part of a generation of children in the state of Texas who began to commit crimes such as capital murder. Aggravated sexual assault, kidnapping, arson, violent crime like that. We were the first children in this state as well as throughout the country who began to be tried, sentenced, and adjudicated for violent crimes such as capital murder and murder. I was charged with capital murder. I was sentenced to 12 years for murder. Spent right at 7 years incarcerated in the Texas Youth Commission, now known today as the Texas Juvenile Justice Department. I'm what you call a state baby. State of Texas invested probably a little over $1 million into my rehabilitation at $120,000 a year. Very expensive to incarcerate a juvenile for 1 year compared to an adult. Very expensive. Had the best education. The world's best psychiatrists and psychologists because the world and our society wanted to know what made kids kill. There was a lady by the name of Debbie Price who wrote an article, Kids Who Kill With No Remorse. Made her famous. Made us look horrible. I bragged about the crime because I was never taught to be remorseful. You was taught that if you hit somebody, say sorry, apologize. But I was never taught to be empathetic. I didn't learn the value of life. But how can you teach someone the value of life when they're in pain? How can you teach me the value of your life or you when I'm in pain? When a person's in pain, man, they don't care about nothing. If you got a stomach ache that's hurting you so bad, you man, I don't care if your toe hurt. So how can you teach somebody when they're in pain? Frederick Douglass said it's easier to create strong children than it is to repair a broken man. And so during the 90s, all the solutions that we have now, we didn't have back then.
Hold on, go back, boy. Shit, hold on, what happened? Boy, that shit was good, wasn't it? That shit was good. Boy, I done asked, I done, how do we go back? Shit. Boy, how we go back? God damn, boy, that shit was good, wasn't it? Boy, that's some good shit. I'm not bullshit. That nigga there is a boy, that nigga there is a hell of a nigga. Y'all can't find nobody on the internet with this kind of knowledge that can articulate it.
Wait, this boy here can.
No, y'all can't do that, man. God damn it, boy, we done lost it. Yeah, I got a long way to drive to the house. Yeah, y'all lost this shit. Y'all lost it, can't find it no more. Man, them niggas be tripping, man. Like I ain't the truth with this shit, man. It's me teaching at a college motherfucking campus, man. And them niggas be, he say he a community activist. He say. Okay.
Back then, I just so happened to be in a state with a governor during a time that juvenile workers and law enforcement agency and law enforcement officials still believed that people could change, particularly children, right? There was nothing punitive about the juvenile system in 1991 when I entered into it during the 90s. There was nothing punitive, nothing about punishment. Everything was focused on resocialization and rehabilitation. In the state of Texas during that time and still today, there's a juvenile law that's called the Texas Juvenile Determined Sentencing Law. And with this law and under this law, a juvenile in this state of Texas, if they commit a felony now, it used to be a violent crime. But today, if a kid commits a felony, they can be sentenced up to 40 years for committing a felony in the state of Texas. And under this law, you go into one of their maximum juvenile security facilities. At the time, it was Giddings State School. You stay in this facility until your 18th birthday. 30 days prior to your 18th birthday, you would come back to your county. You would go before your sentencing judge. Based on your behavior in this facility, based on the heinous of your crime, based on a state recommendation, and based on what your victim had to say, the judge would make a determination to either send you to prison, recommit you back into the Texas Youth Commission, where you could possibly stay an additional 3 years up until your 21st birthday, or parole you. Those were my options. Remember, I told y'all I wanted to go to prison, right? When I got my time, I didn't want to be locked up, but I felt like I had been prepared. All my uncles, I was a kid who was asking questions. Man, what was jail like? What was prison like? Say, Uncle Curtis, I was a kid in the neighborhood with the street guys asking questions about prison and jail, getting prepared. So when I got there, I spent 4 years trying to go to prison. Remember, I said the way you go home is based on your behavior, how you did there. Most kids went there and tried to go home. Man, I went there and I wanted to graduate. My brother then was writing me from prison. A few of my homeboys that was a couple years older than me was writing me from prison, telling me about prison and why they were making it sound fun. I ain't lying, they were making it sound fun. So I joined the game. I hadn't been exposed to the gang culture prior to going into this facility. My mother left the hood so we don't be exposed to that. But when I got inside this juvenile facility, man, and I got exposed to this gang culture, it was everything I was looking for. It was coming from a single parent home with just my mama. It was everything that I was looking for. And I joined it, I excelled in it, I thrived in it, and for long I was a shot caller. By the time I was 18 years old, the state had a strong recommendation for me to go to prison. I earned that recommendation, I should have went, but I didn't go. Had they let me out at the age of 18, I would have committed another murder. I couldn't wait to get out and commit another murder. That's all I fantasized and preoccupied my mind about, because I wanted to go to prison for putting in work for the game. I got a new image, right? The gang culture, by this time in 93, 94, 92, the gang culture is the most influential and most powerful culture throughout this country during this era. You got the gangster image. The gangster image. That's all you see on Yo MTV Raps, Rap City in the Basement. The gangster image. And we learn to develop a hate on top of the pain and the hurt and the anger. We learn to hate one another for a color. Now we got something to direct all our anger towards. A color. So I needed an outlet. But it wasn't who I was. And so I spent 4 years embracing the gang culture. Swearing and you know, saying an oath to my mama, to the facilities, to the workers, that I'm gonna die for this game, that I don't believe in no God, that the Crip God, I mean, I'm denouncing everything, religion, everything, for this game thing. And I'm getting mad at my mama if she come up here with a red shirt on. And she don't know nothing about this game life. This ain't the baby. This ain't that little innocent kid that she knew before he went into this facility. But I'm in an environment now. And I'm a product of this environment. And it's kind of, I like it. I like it. I'm somebody. And I'm good at this. I'm one of the worst ones, mama. And I like it. And I like it. And so, when it was time to go back to court, there were four people who worked on my dorm. Miss Pumple, Mr. Rocha, Mr. Nelson, and Mr. Matthews. Two black men, two white women. And the reason I particularly highlight two white women and two black men is because I was taught we don't trust white people. Where I'm from, mama say white girl go scream rape. We don't date no white girl. Mama them terrified of a black son getting scream raped on by a white woman. They told us don't go in their house. Her daddy them might do something to you. I was taught that. So when I sat in front of a white teacher, man, they said I got that what I was taught. They gonna do you wrong. And then you got these two black men. I despise black men. Black man left me, which was my daddy. I resent a black male authority figure. I blame all y'all for my daddy. He's a gangster. And so here it is. Two women I don't trust and two men I despise. They worked on my dorm for those 4 years. And they was able to see past that little hard facade that I was putting on. And notice that I said facade.
I'll play the rest another day, nigga. Yeah, I got to go pack. I got to hit the road again in the morning. I'll see y'all another time, sucker. See, I keep telling y'all, you niggas ain't got this kind of shit. Nah, you niggas ain't got no kind of history of teaching. Nah, this is me really teaching. And it go on and on and on. Yeah, nah, that's me really teaching right there, man. I'm talking about real life shit.